to talk about quantum Darwinism, otherwise known as quantum spam. And I'm going to talk about, quantum Darwinism, the emergence of, can you see that? Yeah. Of the objective classical world, and in particular, the proliferation of information from a system into the environment. So the question we're asking can be illustrated with this cartoon. Is there a question? No, we have no treaty with nature, unfortunately. So the question we're asking can be illustrated with this cartoon from one of Wojciech's papers. So how does the classical world arise from the quantum substrate? So we have this cartoon. It has a divide. On one side of the divide, we have this quantum world, right? Oops, wrong direction. With these weird things like superpositions, right? A cloud can be in two places at once. A cat can be both alive and dead. And I didn't notice this before, but if you look really closely, there is a beach in the background. And if you squint, you can see Wojciech in a superposition of clothes on and off. On the other side, you have the objective classical world where information can be independently determined by many different observers. So things like, say, my position, or the position of this laser pointer, all of you can independently determine this and come afterward and agree about it. So how does this objective classical world arise from this sort of fundamentally unpredictable quantum substrate? So quantum Darwinism is a framework to understand this question. And as a starting point, it recognizes the role of the environment as a communication channel. So for instance, I mean, we heard about this already yesterday, a little bit with Charlie's talk, but for instance, I'm standing here. There are many different observers. Each of you can learn about my position, say, by intercepting some small fragment of the photon environment. And then you can measure my position and then come afterward to each other and agree, right? So what this allows, just to repeat, it allows many different observers to independently gather information about a system indirectly by intercepting a small fragment of the environment. And redundant information proliferated into the environment gives rise to objectivity, right? So if there's many different copies of the same information in the environment, observers can really independently determine properties or characteristics of some system. So why Darwinism? Well, you can ask Wojciech, but I think the standard answer is the following. Classicality is the result of a selection of a preferred set of states, the so-called pointer states, and the redundant proliferation of information about them into the environment. And there's a certain concept of fitness, and this is the ability of a state to survive and procreate, right? So to survive the interaction with the environment and spawn the most information-theoretic progeny into the environment. All right, so not surprisingly, this is built off of decoherence. In the decoherence paradigm, we have a system embedded in some environment. And we ask questions like, what happens to the state of some quantum system? So for example, if we had a system-environment interaction that was, say, sigma z on the system, interacting with a spin environment, say, sigma z on the spins in the environment, and we started off our state in some superposition, 0 plus 1, right? We look at its density matrix. Under evolution of this generated by this Hamiltonian, we would go to a state where it decoheres, right? This is a conference about decoherence, right? So everybody knows this. And the important thing is that the observable that correlates with the environment here, sigma z on the system, it defines this set of states, these pointer states, that are robust, right? So if we started the system off in just the zero state and we allow it to evolve under this Hamiltonian, nothing would happen to it. It would remain in the zero state. If we started off in the one state, it would remain in the one state. Now we're going to take a slightly different perspective. We're going to take what we can call the redundancy paradigm. So we have a system embedded in some environment, but the environment is not just some large sink for information. Rather, it's composed of many different components where information can, they can each gather information. And we can ask questions like, what information do these components acquire about the system, and how do they acquire it? Other questions we can ask are, for instance, what fragment size of the environment gives complete information about the system. So how many of these different components do we need to gather to learn about the state of the system? And of course, we know the answer is many different fragments give complete information under decoherence. So that was in these early papers on the environment as a witness. So forgive me, I'm going to do a little bit of introduction, but it doesn't so much matter. So if we take a very simple example, system in a superposition 0 plus 1, we put it in contact of a very small environment, E1 and E2, and we allow them to evolve under a C0, right? We would generate this GHZ state. And then we could trace out, say, part of the environment, say, take some fragment of the environment to be E1 or E2, trace it out. We find that the system fragment density matrix is this, where we have a correlated state, a classically correlated state. So if we look at the fragment, if the fragment's in 0, the system's always in 0. If the fragment is in 1, the system's always in 1. And in this case, if we look at the mutual information between the system and the fragment, it's equal to 1, just recognizing that the fragment has learned about the state of the system, whether it's a 0 or a 1, right? And we heard yesterday, right, that the entropy here is just measuring this missing information about the system. And of course, we're going to look at things like just the quantum mutual information defined with von Neumann entropies. And just a few more examples, right? If the system and the fragment were uncorrelated, the mutual information would be 0. If our fragment was the total environment in this example, the mutual information would be twice the entropy of the system, just to recognize that there are quantum correlations that are beyond the classical correlations that are present. And we'll talk about that. And so the typical thing we look at is this information plot. So mutual information versus fragment size. So here measured as a fraction. And if we look at our example, this GHZ state with 2 spins in the environment, if we intercept 0 spins from the environment, we would get no information about the system. If we intercepted a fragment size 1, so 1 spin from the environment, we would get mutual information equals to 1, or the entropy of the system. If we intercepted both, we would get entropy equals 2. Now we can imagine enlarging this state, right? So instead of having 2 spins, have 3 spins. And then look at the plot. So F equals 1, well, the same thing, right? F equals 2, well, we don't actually get any more information. And then finally, when we get the total environment, we have sort of complete quantum correlation with the system, and we jump up to twice the mutual information, or twice the entropy of the system. So enlarge it further, say to 4 spins, same thing. It's not until we get this last spin do we get the quantum correlations with the system. And if we just make it sort of arbitrarily large, what we'll find is that when we go from 0 to 1 spin, we immediately jump up from 0 to HS. But for all the remaining spins, we stay at this level HS until we get the final spin where we jump up to twice the entropy of the system. And this plateau is what we call the classical plateau, right? This is where redundant information has been proliferated into the environment. In this particular example, the redundancy would be the size of the environment, E, right? There's E copies of this information about the system proliferated into the environment. And this state, this GHZ state, is an idealized version of branching states that follow from decoherence. Now, in reality, you don't get this nice idealized case. You get some other curve or some other state that gives rise to some other smooth curve, right? But you still have some rise, and you still have this plateau level. But you won't get to this HS level until you get half the environment. So we define some parameter, this delta called the information deficit, and we say, well, we're not going to require that you have perfect information about the system, but rather to within 1 minus delta, the missing information measured by its entropy. Then if we look at the system with some environment communicating information to observers, and suppose we isolate out one observer, the observer, say, intercepts, say, 1 spin or 1 component of the environment, they might get this much mutual information. 2 spins, they get a little bit more. 3 spins, they get more, and they finally get above this 1 minus delta level. In this case, we would say the redundancy, which now depends on this parameter delta, is the environment size divided by 3. Right? And we can define some fragment size sub delta, that's the fraction size sub delta, that's the fraction of the environment needed to get nearly complete information about the system. And then we can look at the redundancy, it's just 1 over this F sub delta, or the total environment size divided by the fragment sub delta, and this is to get mutual information greater than or equal to this 1 minus delta, the missing information. All right. So one thing about this is we just showed a curve, like this red curve, of the mutual information versus environment size. This is the type of curve that will be generated under decohering interactions. But these are not the most general curve you could get. For instance, if you pulled a random state out of the system environment Hilbert space, you would find a curve more like this green curve, where initially, if you intercept some small fragment of the environment, you gain no information about the system. And it's not until you have nearly half the environment does all of a sudden your mutual information shoot up, and it shoots up almost to twice the entropy, signifying complete quantum correlations with the system. In other words, decohering interactions, they don't uniformly sample Hilbert space. Rather, they generate these particular types of states, these branching states, that give rise to this red curve, or redundant proliferation of information into the environment. All right, an example, which we're going to use later too, so remember it, is just a symmetric spin environment. So here we'll have a system environment interaction. It's just sigma z on the system, sigma z on all the environment spins, an initially factorized state. We give a name to this type of Hamiltonian, pure decoherence, basically. Purely decohering Hamiltonian with independent environment components. So it's only decohering the system, not creating transition between system eigenstates. And the environment components are all doing this independently. So if we write down the system density matrix, of course, it'll get decohered in the pointer basis. It'll have the off-diagonal elements will acquire this decoherence factor. It has this particular form in this case. And we can define some parameter sigma, which I'll come back to, that says something about the initial state of the environment. So if we look at this mutual information plot versus fragment size, so here going up to 200 spins in the environment, versus time, what we see is initially the system is not correlated with the environment fragment, so the mutual information is zero. As time goes on, correlations develop between the system and the environment, and we get this type of curve where we sort of rapidly rise to this classical plateau level, right? So we get the formation of the classical plateau in this case. In this particular example, as t goes to pi over 2, we get the redundancy is actually exactly the size of the environment, and that's because we're generating a perfect GHZ state in this case. So what's happening? So if we look at the initial state of the system in the environment, so initially they're factorized, the system's in the plus state, so superposition of 0 plus 1, environment's in the plus state. As time goes on, this 0 state branches out into some 0 tilde state in the environment. The 1 branches out into some 1 tilde in the environment. And if you look at this on these states, 0 tilde and 1 tilde on the Bloch sphere for the environment qubit, what you see is, well, initially it's in the plus x direction, the red one here. As time goes on, the 1 interacting with the 0 in the system rotates one direction. The 1 interacting with the 1 in the system rotates the other direction. So I should write that. So 0 tilde is this blue state, right? So it rotates in one direction. The 1 tilde is rotating in the opposite direction. And actually, as time goes to pi over 2, you get that the 0 tilde and the 1 tilde are orthogonal. So they acquire a perfect record of the system state. And this is why the redundancy at this particular time goes to the size of the environment. We'll come back to this picture. So quantum Darwinism, environment as a communication channel. The environment will acquire information about preferred states that survive the interaction with it and redundantly proliferate information about those states. Observers can then independently determine the state of the system and reach consensus. And this is what we mean by classicality. So I'm going to discuss three things. First thing will be complementarity of information. Second thing will be proliferation of information. So we'll just go back to this example that we just did and look at under more general conditions. And then finally, I'll talk about state distinguishability and decohering interactions. So the first thing. So let's consider a little bit more generally what happens to information, or what information goes from the system into the environment. And to look at this, we can say, for instance, just choose some POVM on the system, some arbitrary POVM, pi sub s. And if we take the elements of these of this POVM, we can have some probability distribution over different outcomes, s. So s, say, if the system is a spin, s will be 0 and 1. And we'll get some probabilities that this element will occur, or this outcome will occur. And if this outcome occurs, it will proliferate some conditional state into the fragment of the environment, where observers can then infer the state of the system by learning about which state of the environment they have. And so then we can say, well, what's the classical information communicated by the environment in this case? Well, we could measure this with the Halevo quantity, right? We have some probability distribution over input states, or output states rather, of the environment, and this is where the observers learn about the state of the system. Or written in terms of the language that we'll use here, it's the Halevo quantity. It depends on the POVM, on the system, on the fragment of the environment, and it's just the fragment entropy minus the conditional entropy of the fragment given the POVM. All right, so the Halevo quantity. We can also define another quantity that signifies, the Halevo quantity signifies classical information that's communicated by the environment. We can define the quantum discord, so the quantum correlations with that same fragment of the environment. So given some POVM, pi sub s, and the fragment, the quantum discord, I'm sure everybody's heard of, right, is the mutual information, quantum mutual information between the system and the fragment, minus another mutual information that is sort of asymmetric. It's dependent on the POVM on the system. Classically, right, if you had this difference, the quantum or the mutual information minus this asymmetric mutual information, it would be zero. So any non-zero quantity here, it's signifying something quantum about the correlations between the system and the fragment. And well, just to write down the asymmetric mutual information here, it's just the entropy of the fragment minus the conditional entropy of the fragment given this outcome of the POVM. In other words, it's just the Halevo quantity. So I'm sure many of you have heard of this, and many of you have probably studied quantum discord. And you know, there's some question about what exactly is quantum discord measuring. So here, I'm going to give you uncontroversial evidence that quantum discord is powerful. And I'm going to quantify it with numerical numbers. The power of quantum discord is 6.5%. So it's much more than typical old separable states, which are more like 5% or 4%, like Budweiser, but maybe less powerful than entanglement, which is maybe more like 9%. All right, so we have this classical measure of classical correlations, which we're going to take as this, or classical information communicated by the environment, Halevo quantity. We have the discord. And if we look, the mutual information will separate exactly into these two quantities, the Halevo quantity and the discord, which is really nice because the quantum mutual information doesn't specify anything about a measurement of the system. But if you specify a measurement, some POVM, pi sub s, you can divide up classical information that's going to be communicated by the fragment and the quantum correlations with that fragment. All right, so I want to say a few things about what we're going to call complementarity, so sort of the relation between the Halevo quantity and the discord. But first, just another result. If you look at this mutual information plot, so it has this particular form for these decohering interactions, there's one thing that you can say about it. So if you take a pure system environment state and you look at this mutual information, you can relate it, mutual information between the system and a fragment, you can relate it to the mutual information between the system and the complementary fragment, right? So the environment without some fragment. And it turns out, you have to average here, but this relation is true without averaging, but you have to average to get this particular asymmetry. If you actually rotate this curve by 180 degrees, you get back the curve itself. This is great. But it turns out you can do something more, right? If you divide up the correlations to sort of this classical and quantum part, we can relate the discord with respect to this POVM and this complementary fragment, so the environment without the fragment, and we can relate it to the Halevo quantity also with respect to this POVM and this fragment. So it's the discord on this complementary fragment is equal to the entropy of the system minus the Halevo quantity with respect to the fragment. What does that mean? So if you look at graphically, so here is plotted both chi and discord by itself versus fragment of the environment. So if you look at the Halevo quantity, it's this blue curve. And what this relation says, it says that the discord on this side of the curve for large fragments is related to the entropy of the system minus the Halevo quantity on this side. In other words, if you have redundant information, meaning if you have this Halevo quantity and sort of pumping it up so it's closer and closer to the classical plateau and closer to the classical plateau for smaller and smaller fragment sizes, it means that you're going to push down the discord on this side. So it's going to become smaller and smaller until eventually it's just correlations with essentially the whole environment. Meaning, if you lose any small, tiny fragment of your environment, the quantum correlations that are present with respect to the system in the environment will all be lost and be inaccessible to you. And you will only have access to these redundant correlations. Now, you might object this was for a pure system and an environment and a rank one POVM. I didn't say that. But you can actually say for an arbitrary system and environment state, we have a similar relation, except it's a bound. It says that the discord on this right-hand side of the curve is upper bounded by the entropy of the system minus the label quantity on this other side of the curve. Right? So what it's saying is that, sort of unequivocally, if you have redundant information proliferated into your environment, the quantum information is going to be inaccessible to you unless you really have the full environment. And it's interesting. This curve of the quantum discord, in this case, that it stays sort of flat and then it rises to HS near the end when you have the global environment. It's something actually that shows up in discord all over the place. So if we have the discord here, and we plot it versus this fragment size, we have this behavior where we have a sharp upturn when we get nearly all the fragment. If you look at the number of papers on discord versus this should be really accumulated, but forgive me, I didn't have time. But it stays sort of flat until you get to the present time where it just all of a sudden shoots up. But it's not everything. It really shows up. Anything that has to do with discord, this type of curve will show up. In fact, Wojciech liked this curve so much, he decided to organize his desktop based on this behavior. So this is a reconstruction, but it says Wojciech, see, right here. And if you look at the distribution of files on his desktop, you see that it's very sparse away from the top right-hand corner. And then there's quite a lot here. And it's actually more there than you actually think. So if you narrow this down, and we're going to convert this to a 1D plot. So we're going to average over, say, the Y direction here and plot it versus the X direction. And if you do that, what you find is it looks exactly like this. It's nearly flat until you get to the full desktop, and then it all of a sudden shoots up. And there's really a lot of files here. And this is a true story. So if you look at, it's great that file size is also measured in bits. And if you look at the number of files on this side of the curve, it's about 50 gigabits. I'll save the rest of the story for some other time. But this is a true story. It really is something like 50 gigabits. And I can suggest that, in fact, we can define some new unit of measure of entropy, the Wojciech. It's like a fundamental constant. And circa about... and circa 2010, it was about 50 gigabits. But unlike other fundamental constants, it's increasing in time. Maybe some other ones, right? We don't know. But all right. So what is this sort of, we did two things. One, we have this sort of complementary behavior between classical information proliferated into the environment and quantum information. And we saw that there's sort of this asymmetry property relating them. That high redundancy, so a lot of information at small fragments of the environment implies very low quantum information. But we can look at this maybe more generally if we look at the mutual information in this division. I wrote it the opposite way, but discord with respect to this POVM plus Halevo quantity, and we can look at what happens when we change this POVM, right? So if we have this quantum mutual information versus fragment size, it's fixed, right? It's given by whatever the system fragment state is, or system environment state is, rather, and you'll get whatever curve. But if you divide it up into the different, divide it up into discord and Halevo quantity, pick a POVM. So here on the left, it's shown if you pick the POVM to be the pointer states in this particular example. So the pointer states is the sigma z states. You'll find that, Halevi quantity with respect to the pointer basis is this initial increase, and that the discord with respect to the pointer basis is this rise on the opposite end. In fact, you can prove that for these models, that Halevi quantity is maximized when you choose the POVM to be the pointer basis. Or alternatively, the discord is minimized if you choose the POVM to be the pointer basis. So if you change the POVM, so here we're going to just take some other basis, and we're going to we're just going to take an angle, rotate, take a basis with respect to some angle. I'm going down to the y-axis. And you look that you change the relative amounts of the Halevi quantity and the discord. Of course, their sum still has to add up to the quantum mutual information. You can change it a little bit more. OK, now discord's more than Halevi quantity. And if you get down to a basis which is complementary, and now I'm using it maybe in two different ways, this word complementary. So if you take this basis down to something in this xy plane, so here on the y-axis, you'll find that the discord makes up this side of the curve, and the Halevi quantity makes on this opposite side. And you can make sense of this, because we're generating this branching state. It's very much like this GHZ state, sort of. And what this is saying is that, well, if you want to, say, predict whether or learn about whether the system is in the y plus or y minus, or x plus and x minus, if you want to do that, so you want to learn that classical information about the system, you really need the whole environment. And the discord is just what's sort of left over. And you can take another viewpoint. What is the discord representing here? Well, you can say, well, somehow this Halevi quantity with respect to this complementary basis, it looks a lot like the discord with respect to the pointer basis. It turns out it's equal, more or less, up to exponentially small corrections in the environment size. So if you take the environment size very large, they're effectively equal. So you can say, well, this discord here is just effectively the pointer Halevi. It's true, but it also represents maybe something else. So it's how much information or how much correlations would be lost between the system and the fragment if you had some auxiliary environment or apparatus that measured in the sigma y basis, right? So if you had some auxiliary, so say some other apparatus that measured sigma y of the system directly with the system, it would destroy this amount of correlations with the current environment. All right, so we can look at other things. For instance, this is just a plot of the Halevi quantity versus fragment size versus this angle here that gives the basis. So when the angle is zero, right, this is this pointer basis, goes all the way down to sigma y, or sigma x in this case. And we can look at this plateau level. It drops. So if we look at the Halevi quantity with respect to the POVM versus fragment size, we can show that the plateau level will go down as the entropy of this POVM minus the conditional entropy of the POVM given the outcome of the pointer measurement. So this is a result that extends, it's actually the way I wrote it here, it's equivalent to an earlier result, but we have it now for mixed states in general. And we can show that the corrections to this when we don't have sort of a perfect record is going to be something exponential in the fragment size. So it's something small. So beyond this point, if we take this view that you have to have more than 1 minus delta of the information, so beyond this white line here, you can have no more redundant proliferation of information. So if you look at, say, the redundancy with respect to some delta, right, versus here's the action, don't worry about it too much, versus this angle, you'll see that beyond some angle here, you can't have any redundancy, but below it, you have very extensive redundancy. All right, so this is the first result, complementarity of information. Conclusion, basically, is that redundancy implies the lack of access to quantum correlations and complementary information about the system. It appeared yesterday, finally. Okay, second result. It's actually a collection of results. So just to look at this particular model that I already put up, and look at the proliferation of information into the environment. And we're going to look at a restricted class of Hamiltonians. So we want Hamiltonians that decohere the system. But we're going to look at a particular Hamiltonians that have this form. So there's some Hamiltonian in the system, but it's going to be somewhat trivial. And then we're going to have our pointer observable, right, that's getting correlated with the environment, some operators on the individual environment modes, and the environments can have some self-Hamiltonian too. The system Hamiltonian, we want it to commute with this pointer observable, so we don't create transitions between the eigenstates of the system, right? So this is what we mean by pure decoherence. And then further, the initial state, we want a factorized initial state, so we can say that both with the factorized initial state and the interaction to all the environment modes individually, we're interacting with independent environment components, right? So this type of Hamiltonian is the type that we think models what the photon environment does. Photons interact with the system, then they go off and they don't interact with each other, and then observers can accumulate information later on. Now, the nice thing about this is that under this type of evolution, the mutual information, when you have a very large environment, is just exactly the Halevo quantity with respect to the pointer basis, right? So this type of evolution is broadcasting only classical information about the pointer basis into the environment. All right, so we're going to go back. For this example, we're not going to take the general form here, although we will go back to the general form, but rather we're going to do our symmetric case. And we're going to ask, how does the proliferation of information change for different initial states of the environment? So just some examples of non-ideal environments. If you had a completely mixed state of the environment, so it's proportional just to the identity, right, on the environment, this would still decohere the system, right, but it won't accumulate classical information, or it won't redundantly accumulate information. Or, for instance, if you took an eigenstate, took the environment spin, right, to be in an eigenstate of the interaction Hamiltonian, for example, just the zero state, right, this also would not evolve under this Hamiltonian, and it would not accumulate information about the system. In other words, in these two cases, the mutual information is zero, right? And just more generally, you can just take whatever mixture of these eigenstates of the interaction Hamiltonian. So what happens sort of in between, right? So we have these cases that I already showed you where you have this pure state and the plus state the environment spin in the plus state. There's a particular time where it perfectly acquires a record about the system. So what happens between that case and these sort of non-ideal cases? And we define some names. We call the case where you have mixture haziness, right? So it just says your initial state, it doesn't lie on the surface of the black sphere, but some contracted sphere. And then we have something that we'll call misalignment. And this is just the environment state at some angle from sort of the state that acquires the most information, right? So the state that acquires the most information is any state in the XY plane. The sigma z states of the environment spins would acquire no information, right? So misalignment is just how close are you to, or how far are you rather from this xy axis, xy point. And we want to know, if you have a curve initially that's this black solid curve for the mutual information versus fragment size, how does that move when you make the environment sort of non-ideal? Oops, I hit it too many times. So we already saw this curve. So this is initially factorized state. Here the entropy, and on this left-hand curve, the entropy is zero, so we have a pure initial state. It's in a plus state, actually. And we see this curve as before, right? There's no mutual information initially, but as time goes on, correlations develop, we get this classical plateau formation. But if we take a hazy environment, right? So one with some initial entropy, quite large amount of entropy, 0.8. And if we look at the same figure, mutual information versus fragment size versus time, we see that, well, in fact, it doesn't look too much different. Maybe it takes a little bit longer for the formation of the plateau, but otherwise the plateau forms. So in both cases, classical plateau still forms. One other thing to notice is sort of the initial rate of information gain as you acquire one spin from the environment. It's 1 minus the entropy, initial entropy of the environment spin.
Mike, this picture on the left, it looks like it's not okay. I can't do that. Looks like there's a model rate.
Here?
Yeah. Like if this were a chair.
Yeah, I think it's probably just a plotting style. So it wouldn't, there would not be an armrest there. No.
Okay, it has to.
So I think it's just an artifact of you're probably seeing some shading, right? Yeah. We're all seeing some shading. But yeah, no, it won't form a armrest. All right, so if you look at, this is going to be the hazy case. Now this is mutual information versus fragment size versus haziness, right? So not time. And if you look, so zero haziness is the pure state, and this is at this particular time, pi over 2. So the pure state case forms this perfect GAZ state, right? So you immediately jump to the classical plateau and you go over. And if you look for all haziness, and really it only goes to like 0.95 here, but you can see that the classical plateau forms. And in fact, if we made the environment bigger and bigger, the classical plateau would always form except for haziness equals to 1. So completely mixed. And I don't know why this is blue. I'll have to fix that. But just ignore the blueness. If you look at the redundancy versus haziness, this is for delta equals 0.1, right? This information deficit. You see this solid curve that's sort of half black and half blue, unfortunately, right? It has this sort of stair-stepping behavior. It's finite size effects. But you see that there's redundancy for all values of haziness. As the haziness goes to 1, so a completely mixed state, you get this behavior that the redundancy looks like it's 1 minus the initial entropy of the environment state. So it looks sort of like a noisy channel. That's the red curve here. It's just a linear fit. The blue curve, the other blue curve, that's sort of continuous, I'll talk about a little bit later. All right, and you can look at this sort of behavior for any time versus haziness. You'll get this 1 minus h behavior. You'll get redundancy for all haziness. So it's nothing to do with the particular time. All right, misalignment, right? So these are states not in the xy plane, sort of you're going out of the xy plane and somehow being imperfect. So misalignment equals 0 means you're in the xy plane. This is this parameter sigma from an earlier slide. Don't worry too much about how it's defined. 0 means it's in the xy plane. 1 means it's aligned with the z-axis, right? And if we're looking at mutual informations versus fragment size, we also see that the classical plateau forms for all values of misalignment, right? And if we look at redundancy, there'll be redundancy for all values of misalignment. I'll talk about these continuous curves later. Actually, the blue one, not the red one. You can look at different times. Same thing, right? So what we can take from this, I mean, it was a particular model. It had a symmetric environment. But we can take that, in this case, redundancy is reduced when you sort of take these non-ideal environments, mixture or misalignment. But it only vanishes for what we can say measure zero initial conditions, completely mixed environment or something that is an eigenstate of the interaction Hamiltonian. Only for those particular conditions. All other conditions, you will get redundancy always. And actually, the last one is basically going to be a proof that these purely decohering models always give redundancy, except for these measure zero initial conditions. So state distinguishability and decohering interactions. So the viewpoint here is we're going to consider these purely decohering Hamiltonians by independent environment components. And instead of looking at, say, the Halevo quantity or mutual information, we're going to just try to extract information by actually measuring the environment, right? So we're going to actually have the observer try to distinguish the different states that are generated on the environment and learn about the state of the system. And in particular, I said we wouldn't look at the Halevo quantity, but we're going to sort of look at the Halevo quantity, but we're going to put bounds. I'm only going to talk about the lower bound, where we actually tried to measure the environment fragment and extract this information. Upper bound was provided by Rogofanis and Shitskovsky in this 2010 paper. I'll not talk about it really, but I'll state the result and how it pertains to our case. All right, so the lower bound is just going to be we're going to make a measurement on the fragment, and we're going to bound the Halevo quantity from below by measuring the fragment. They're both computable. So in pictures, what we're going to take is we want to infer the system state. So if initially we have some state that say it's 0 plus 1, I write it 1 plus 0 because 1 is going to go to the left, 0 is going to go to the right. But 0 plus 1 on the system, some state on the fragment, say it's sigma, so it's pointing in some direction. We know, as we wrote before, that the state that sort of gets correlated with the 0 is going to go one direction, right? It's going to go into this 1 tilde state. The state that gets correlated with the 1 is going to go into this 1 tilde state in the opposite direction. Now, if we put the observer in and the observer intercepts some fragment of the environment, the observer can ask themselves a question, right? Do they have the 1 tilde or the 0 tilde state, right? And if they can determine whether they have 1 tilde or 0 tilde, they can determine whether they're correlated with the 0 or a 1 on the system, right? So they can infer the system state. Now, I wrote it as a pure state, but we can take equally well just some mixture. And sorry, I changed some notation here. This is just the probability that 1 occurs and the probability that 0 occurs. And actually, we don't even have to have symmetric states. So I'm going to write down results for just you can have different states on all the different environment components rather than some symmetric state, tensor power f. All right, lower bound. One thing here doesn't matter too much. So the lower bound is just saying that the Halevi quantity, so the classical information sort of communicated by the fragment, we're going to lower bound it by a mutual information where the system is completely decohered. Actually, if you pay attention carefully, this is already sort of applied at the level of the Halevi quantity, but don't worry. The other map here is going to make a measurement on the fragment to try to distinguish, say, if we have this zero or one state on the system, it's going to try to distinguish, say, this rho zero or rho zero power f, or whatever state, you know, the conditional state on f given zero on the system, from the conditional state on f given one on the system. And let's suppose the observer tries to do this. And let's suppose the real state is rho zero, or conditional state on f given zero on the system. They're going to obtain that they get the zero state with some success probability, 1 minus the error probability. They're going to obtain 1, the incorrect answer, right, with some error probability, PE. And vice versa with rho sub 1. If rho sub 1 is the true state, they'll obtain 0 with some error probability and 1 with some 1 minus error success probability, 1 minus the error probability. And here we're limiting ourselves to two-dimensional system, right? So there's two states sort of proliferated into the environment. And we can calculate the error probability using the Hellstrom measurement. So in other words, our lower bound is something like where we apply this measurement on f, and it's essentially we're going to give the entropy of the system minus the entropy of this error probability. If there was zero error probability, we would get the entropy of the system. We can perfectly learn about the state of the system. If there's not, this accessible information is reduced by this error probability. All right. So we have a lower bound, which is this HS minus the entropy of the error probability. We have an upper bound. So this is the form from this paper I mentioned that I'm not going to really talk about. But if we just write it out, we get that the upper bound is the entropy of the system minus something order the error probability squared. The lower bound is something order error probability log the error HS minus the error probability log the error probability. And the nice thing is we know how to calculate this error probability for states that have this product form. And it's the quantum Chernoff bound. And it just says, well, we have the error probability, it's equal to, the minimum error probability is given by this Hellstrom measurement or this Hellstrom form. And if we look at the quantum Chernoff bound, it says that this error probability is going to go down exponentially with the size of the fragment. And the exponent that characterizes this exponential decay is the quantum Chernoff bound. And it has this particular form. One nice thing about it, there's a few nice things. One is that it involves only a single component of the environment, right? So instead of dealing with some operator that's on the environment's total Hilbert space, you end up dealing with just an environment, a state or states on a single environment component. So that's nice from a calculational point of view. There's another nice thing, and it goes to how this result was proved. You don't have to have symmetric states here. You don't have to have the states all to be in some, you know, rho 1 to the tensor power f. You can have, you know, rho, you know, 1 for fragment 1, some rho 1 prime for fragment 2, et cetera. Like, they can all be different. And I'm not going to go through all the work, but eventually what pops out is that the redundancy sub delta is going to be equal to, I'm hiding some stuff, but I'll tell you what I'm hiding, equal to the environment size times the quantum Chernoff bound, so this exponent, that characterizes this decay of the error probability, divided by log delta. So there's a few nice things now. One is that this quantum Chernoff bound shows up, so we don't need to compute anything to do with entropies or information or actual measurements on these large fragments. We compute something just about that gives some distinguishability measure of states on individual environment components. The other nice thing is you see that this log delta shows up. So delta, remember, is in some sense artificial. You can't get perfect information about the system in general. So you choose, say, delta to be 0.1 or 10 to the minus 3 or whatever. But you would like redundancy not to be very dependent on this parameter. And this shows, in fact, it is. It's only log delta. So if you choose delta to be 10 to the minus 10, we get a factor of 10, more or less, in log 2 or log 10. And also, the redundancy is proportional to the environment size. Right? So it's environment size divided by log delta times this measure of distinguishability, which is this quantum Chernoff bound or quantum Chernoff information. All right, how well does this work? I'll have to tell you the things I'm hiding. This is the redundancy curve versus the haziness, right? So that's the black curve. This was computed exactly on very large environments, even for mixtures. The blue curve here is this result I just said. Redundancy is equal to the environment size divided by log delta. I canceled some minus signs. The quantum turnoff bound in this case is log square root of 4 times lambda minus times lambda plus. Lambda minus and lambda plus are the eigenvalues of the initial density matrix of a single environment spin. Right, so they give some measure of this distinguishability. Right, so if you have a pure state, one of these will be 0, and your redundancy will diverge. If you have a completely mixed state, each one of these would be 1/2. It would cancel with the 2, and you would get 1, and you get log 1, and you would get 0 redundancy. Now, I say that these are equal, but clearly they're not equal. Right? So one thing that was being hidden is the following. So this result with the quantum turnoff bound, it's asymptotic, right? So it's for very, as f goes to infinity. Right? Clearly, in this case, where the environment size was 200, we don't have f goes to infinity. F is more like, say, 1 right here, or 2, et cetera. So it's a very small number. So you have to take this limit where delta goes to 0, or f sub delta, the fragment size that you need, goes to infinity. And so we can define some concept or some normalized redundancy, which is this limit as delta goes to 0, or f delta goes to infinity, with r delta times log delta divided by the environment size. And if we believe this quantum turnoff result, right, it is this quantum turnoff bound. And in fact, if we take this limit, we find that r delta, well, for these numerically computed cases, which are these points, are exactly equal to the quantum turnoff bound, which is this black solid line here. And the other nice thing, I switched notations, this is P0, remember. The other nice thing is this result, let's go back, it doesn't have anything to do with the system, right? It doesn't say any prior probabilities of being in the 0 or 1 state, they don't show up here. So it also means that for whatever P0 and P1 I put in, I should get the same result. And indeed, it's true. I take, say, P0 to be quite small. Yet, when you go to this asymptotic limit, you get exactly this quantum turnoff bound. Redundancy collapses onto a universal curve. You can do this for other cases. So this is for a pure environment, some different times. And well, the blue curve here is the quantum turnoff result, which is log the decoherence factor squared with the other factors here. And yeah, it sort of fits well in this finite case. But as you take delta to 0, everything falls onto a universal curve, which is the quantum turnoff bound. This is a different time, same thing. Right? Everything falls onto some universal curve. It's given just by the properties of the environment. All right. There's not much here that I'm going to go into detail, at least. So this turnoff, quantum turnoff bound, it gives some measure of distinguishability of different states that are generated on the fragment of the environment. And so if we look at, for instance, the block sphere of an individual environment component, we can look at these states, these sort of 0 tilde and the 1 tilde states that are going to rotate in different directions. So on this upper curve, we have two curves. They sort of fall on top of each other, but they're going in different directions. They start at this point. One goes one direction, and the other one goes the other direction. Right? And they give sort of how the state of the environment spin is changing in time. We can do this. We can apply some field that the environment spins feel as well, and we'll get some curves that sort of they deviate from each other. But again, the blue curve is the 0 state. The red curve is the 1, or sorry, 0 tilde state, and the red curve is the 1 tilde state. And sort of how far they go from each other on this block sphere gives how distinguishable they are. And if you go and you compute, so for a single environment spin, what is this quantum turnoff bound? You'll find it has this nice form. There's two pieces here. There's a cosine squared of theta over 2. Theta is going to be the dot product of the two block vectors that give these two different 0 tilde and 1 tilde spins in the environment. So if the environment was pure, this piece would go away because it involves the eigenvalues here, right? One of them is going to be 0. It would go away. You would get that the turnoff bound is exactly equal to something that involves just the angle that is generated between these two states. If your state becomes, or environment state becomes somewhat mixed, right, this term will start to kick in, right? But it still only involves the dot product of these block vectors plus something that involves just the initial mixedness of the environment spin. And if, you know, lambda minus and lambda plus, right, they each go to 1/2 for a perfectly mixed state, right, you'll find that you get cosine squared plus sine squared, it's 1, you get 0, right? So you see that, in fact, only when the angle is 0 or that you're perfectly mixed is this quantum Chernoff bound 0. And notice I put in some things that were missing from the other slide. I put in like an average, because you don't need to have this symmetric state on the environment. They can all be different states. And if you want to compute what the quantum Chernoff bound is in that case, it's sort of like an average, hence the bar. But you only average over the states of a single environment components, right? So you average this over the single environment components. So it gives a nice compact expression and also gives you a way to sort of visualize how different states are accumulating information. In fact, if you map these block sphere into some other shape in 3 dimensions, so this other shape is just, it's sort of a torus, where the extent of the torus at any given point is this quantum Chernoff bound. So it shows how the environment state's ability to accept information is as a function of its point on the block sphere. So in other words, if you look at any of these, they're very big in the xy direction, because the xy plane are the states of sort of maximum acceptability. And it goes to 0 exactly at the z-axis, because these states don't accept any information. If you apply some field, you actually get the identical shape. So this is a field to the environment components. You get, it's really the identical shape, it's just rotated a little bit. So you can show that they have the exact same form. They have some sort of, you know, plane of maximum extent and some unpreferred axis that's rotating in time, and you can calculate this. So it gives a nice way to visualize these results. So state distinguishability and decohering interactions. Well, one thing that this is saying is that, well, redundancy is universal for these pure decoherence models. If you have pure decoherence by these independent environment components, you'll always get redundancy, except for these measure zero cases. All right. Just to conclude, quantum Darwinism. We have a preferred set of states, these pointer states, that survive and spawn the most information theoretic progeny, which is communicated by the environment. We showed, well, the mutual information has this decomposition into something that measures classical correlations with respect to some POVM on S and the fragment of the environment, and something that measures quantum correlations. We have this anti-symmetry property of information. It says the discord on one end of the curve is equal to HS minus Halevo on the other end of the curve. And we can make it an inequality if we want mixed states. But what you should take home, right, is that information is communicated redundantly and hence objectively. If information, sorry, is communicated redundantly and hence objectively, then quantum correlations cannot be present except for nearly the whole environment, right? So you'll never have access to them. These purely decohering models only proliferate classical information about the pointer bases. And the redundancy is given by the Chernoff information. And here, there was another thing that I was sweeping under the rug. The proof actually only shows that the redundancy, the limiting redundancy, is within a factor of 2 of this expression. So you can't say exactly equals, although all the models we solve, it seems to be equal. And it's given by this expression. All right, so I'm going to leave you with a riddle. Now, I've seen some versions of this riddle in other places, so I don't deserve complete credit for it, but it's a nice riddle. Humpty Dumpty sat in a representation. Humpty Dumpty had a great unitary transformation. And all the king's horses and all the king's men couldn't locally put Humpty together again. Thank you.
Thank you, Mike, for that good talk and the painting of Hunk. So how do you think about this? Are there questions?
Well, I was wondering where the grandchildren were, because that's the suggestion of an alternate name for this has to do with the reproduction all happening at the beginning. Do we have examples where you get where you get second generation environments that get that copy the same stuff from the first generation environment?
So, realistic examples?
Yeah.
I'm not sure. Certainly, you can make contrived examples.
Well, we do, like when JFK was shot, right? People found out because other people told them, because they had heard it on the radio, because et cetera, right?
Yeah.
But it's hard to write
on the radio. Already classical, by the way.
Well, I mean, so we can easily. Let me correct. So we can easily write.
Classical after the first, by definition.
Yeah.
We can easily write a Hamiltonian. I mean, in fact, with Jess, right, we solved the Hamiltonian. That is this: if the environment interacts with some other environment, with say a ZZ interaction, not unlike the system, it will accumulate the information, right? And it will. And I mean, what Jess showed is that if the environment interacts with itself, it somehow hides the information. But if it interacted with another auxiliary environment, that would, you know, transfer. That would be the grandchildren, right?
I think the basic issue is we're so used to photons and so on. The electromagnetic field is linear, so that's that. But any nonlinear environment will have grandchildren.
What about let's just say decoherence in the dark by air molecules?
I think what would concern me is the following. If you have something that has some interaction that maybe would generate grandchildren, it's probably also doing something like thermalizing the state.
Yeah, that's
and so you might generate a grandchild.
But not lots.
But yeah. Maybe half a grandchild.
Good point.
Okay.
So when you consider a noisy environment, you gain the parameter of its entropy. But right, so but I was wondering whether it's important also the basis in which it's mixed, the eigenbasis in the CMU environment.
Oh, I mean, it does matter. I didn't put those curves. So if you look at our paper, we have both changing sigma, this misalignment, and the entropy at the same time. Right, so we did that case. 100%, right? You still get redundancy everywhere. And not only that, you have this 1 minus delta, or sorry, 1 minus the entropy behavior for the redundancy. You also get that in that case, although it's 1 minus the entropy divided by the maximum entropy that the environment state can attain. But we did those cases as well. I didn't show them here, though.
Are there more questions or comments? So it's for lunch, and lunch will be upstairs, like
yesterday. Yep. Thank you.